So in the last lecture, we look at these boundary layer equations, right? We looked at continuity, at momentum, and enthalpy, and we could integrate these equations subject to these boundary conditions. For instance, at the surface of the plate, if this is the plate, and this is the wall normal axis, at the surface of the plate, the boundary condition is just that the velocity needs to be zero. And the boundary condition for the temperature is just that the temperature needs to be equal to a wall temperature, or that the gradient of the temperature needs to be zero, right, if the wall is adiabatic. And then far away from the wall, the velocity needs to recover the edge velocity, and the temperature also needs to be equal to the edge temperature. Well, we mentioned too that these equations are two-dimensional, right? You can also encounter three-dimensional boundary layers that are even more difficult. But there is an important simplification that can be made, or an important reformulation of these equations based on similarity variables, right? And those similarity variables are, for instance, this xi, which is the integral from 0 to x of rho sub v, mu sub v, u sub v with respect to x. And this eta, which is actually equal to u sub e divided by the square root of 2xi and multiplied by the integral from 0 to y of the density. So one can consider these two similarity variables. At the end of the day, this is just a transformation similar to the Howard-Dorodichin transformation, in which you have a density weighting of, for instance, of the variable eta that is going to be a variable important for characterizing the wall normal structure of a profile. And then on top of that, what you could do is to define, for instance, a stream function. So this stream function is defined as a these two equations. So rho multiplied by u will be equal to dip c dy, and rho multiplied by v will be equal to minus dip c dx. So psi here is the stream function. By using the stream function, I automatically satisfy the continuity equation. In addition, one could also propose a transformation for the stream function. For instance, one can define psi as the square root of 2xi multiplied by a function f of eta in such a way that one separates the xi dependency from the eta dependency. And then if one substitutes this definition into this equation for the stream function, one would obtain that the velocity u could be expressed as a net velocity that in general is going to depend on xi multiplied by f prime of eta. So primes here, they denote the derivatives with respect to eta. Well, so I think we went over a very long derivation to derive the transformed versions of the momentum and the enthalpy equation. So for instance, for the enthalpy, one could also define here the enthalpy as an H enthalpy that in general is going to depend on xi multiplied by a function g that is only a function of eta. So if one inserts these relations here into these equations, then one could transform, for instance, the momentum equation into the following. So the first term, the viscous stress term, will be transformed into a parameter c multiplied by f second, everything derived once, plus f multiplied by f second. This will be equal to 2xi multiplied by the gradient of the velocity of the streamwise velocity, and this multiplied by f prime square minus rho sub v divided by rho. So then the enthalpy equation, right, will become the following, will become c multiplied by g prime and derive once. Then plus F multiplied by G prime. This will be equal to 2C multiplied by this will be 1 over HE, EHE DC multiplied by F prime G. And here I will have plus rho sub E, U sub E divided by rho multiplied by H sub E. And here we have the derivative of the streamer velocity with respect to C and F prime here. And minus another term that will be C multiplied by F second, multiplied by U sub E square divided by H sub E and multiplied by F second square. So this will be the two conservation equations for momentum and for enthalpy, right? So these conservation equations, they need to be integrated subject to boundary conditions. So these boundary conditions will be that y equals 0. And in non-slip boundary conditions, right, y equals 0 is representative of eta equals 0. And I will need that f prime needs to be equal to 0. And in addition to f prime, if you recall also, the vertical velocity depends on f. So that if there is no penetration into the plate, I also need that f has to be equal to 0. Then the enthalpy g has to be equal to a value, g sub w, or the derivative g prime needs to be equal to 0, depending on whether the wall is isothermal or the wall is adiabatic. And then at eta tending to infinity, then f prime needs to be equal to 1 because I need to recover the edge velocity, and the enthalpy needs to be equal to 1 because I need to recover the edge enthalpy, right? So you can see here how one will recover those values if g is equal to 1 and f prime is equal to 1 at infinity. So this will be the problem that one would need to integrate. So in this problem there was also a parameter here, C. This parameter C is called the Chapman-Rubensin parameter, that is given by rho multiplied by mu and divided by rho sub E and multiplied by mu sub E. By the way, here I have forgotten a Prandtl number, so there should be a Prandtl number there. Well, so with this, pretty much the problem is closed. The main problem here is that I need some information about these quantities, right? So before going to that, let me just tell you too that if the gas is calorically perfect, then there are simplifications that I can make in these equations. For instance, when I look at the momentum equation, this term is the divergence of the viscous shear stress. This term here is the wall normal convection. This term here, multiplying f prime square, is the streamwise convection. And this term here is the pressure gradient, the streamwise pressure gradient. So if the gas is calorically perfect, then I can transform this into G, right? Directly, because I know that the enthalpy, right, is going to be just A sub E is going to be just Cp multiplied by T sub E. And as a result, G is not only the dimensionless enthalpy, but it's also the dimensionless temperature. And as a result, because of the equation of a state, this is also the inverse of the dimensionless density. So in this equation, if the gas is calorically perfect, then I could replace this, for instance, this term here by G. Right? Now, in this equation, I think it is fine, right? Everything that happens here is fine. In the boundary condition here, this boundary condition was initially for the enthalpy, right? So that would be the enthalpy at the wall. Well, the enthalpy at the wall depends on the temperature at the wall through an integral, because if the gas is not calorically perfect. So if the gas is not calorically perfect, in general, the enthalpy has to be calculated from an integral equation, right? The temperature needs to be calculated from an integral equation. So that will be this one. If the gas is calorically perfect, then H is linearly proportional to the temperature. And then I can simplify all of this, right? And I know that H is equal to Cp multiplied by T. So this GW, then it becomes not only the wall enthalpy normalized by the H enthalpy, but it also becomes the wall temperature divided by the H temperature. So the problem becomes much easier. So if the gas is calorically perfect too, I can define a characteristic quantity here that is called the stagnation temperature, right? So the stagnation temperature, I could define a dimensionless stagnation temperature as T naught equal to T naught at the edge multiplied by this self-similar function M of eta. This T naught at the edge is doomed to be uniform because the flow outside the plate, right, the flow outside the boundary layer above the plate, this flow is isentropic. So as a matter of fact, this edge stagnation temperature needs to be uniform. So I could construct an equation for M based on these two equations just by saying that M of eta, by definition, is equal to the static portion of the temperature, which would be just G of eta, that would be multiplied by the edge temperature divided by the stagnation temperature at the edge, plus U sub E squared divided by 2Cp multiplied by F prime squared of eta. So if I manipulate these two equations, by the way, if I construct here a kinetic energy equation by multiplying this by F prime, and I sum it to this equation, right? I sum it, then one will be capable of constructing an equation for M of eta that you can do on your own, and you will obtain an equation like this. So it will be C multiplied by M prime divided by the Prandtl number, plus F multiplied by M prime minus U sub E squared divided by 2 Cp T0E, and then multiplied by C, and multiplied by 1 over the Prandtl number minus 1, multiplied by F prime, F second, all of this prime. I don't need these two here. So that will be the equation for the stagnation enthalpy, and for the stagnation temperature, and for instance, far away from the plate, the stagnation temperature at infinity, the stagnation temperature needs to recover the H stagnation temperature, so M needs to become 1. And on the plate, well, the stagnation temperature and the static temperature, they need to be the same because the velocity is 0. So here, this stagnation temperature needs to be equal so if I look at this relation, for instance, here, right? So at the wall, this term is 0 because there is no, the velocity is 0. So as a result, this gives me the boundary condition for the stagnation temperature. So that will be T sub E divided by T0E multiplied by GW, which is the value of G at the wall. So that will be equal to GW divided by 1 plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 and multiplied by the Mach at the H squared. All right, so I could integrate the momentum equation and the enthalpy equation, or I could integrate the momentum equation and the stagnation temperature equation. This is equal to 0. And the stagnation temperature equation, right? So I could pick what quantities to, or what equations to integrate. I don't need the three of them, right? I only need two. Well, there is an additional simplification here, right, that is required when the gas is calorically perfect. And is if we look at this prefactor here multiplying the viscous dissipation. So by the way, this if one looks at this relation here, so this term here is the divergence of the heat flux. This term here is the transversal convection of enthalpy, right? So this term here is a streamwise convection of enthalpy. This term here is the pressure work term, so the work done by the pressure gradient. And this term here will be the viscous dissipation. So you can see a direct correspondence between the different terms in this equation here and the terms here. So in the viscous dissipation, if the gas is calorically perfect, then one can say that this term is equal to gamma minus 1 multiplied by the Mach number squared. So the viscous dissipation depends on the Mach number squared. And as I emphasized in the last lecture, this term becomes important at high Mach numbers. In contrast, at low Mach numbers, the effect of the viscous dissipation in the entire thermal field is negligible, right? And that is because at very low Mach numbers, there is a lot more of thermal energy than kinetic energy, by definition. So if there is any dissipation of kinetic energy, that dissipation is going to contribute very little to the entire field of thermal energy. Well, so as you can see here too, there are terms that depend on xi, right? That prevent, in principle, these equations to be globally self-similar, right? So as I mentioned before, one can transform these equations into either a locally self-similar problem in which I give you the values of these gradients locally, right? Or one can transform the problem in an exactly self-similar problem. Just for instance, what happens in a boundary layer with zero pressure gradients. So for instance, if I take here a zero pressure gradient boundary layer, I know that because of the Euler equation on the inviscid stream above the plate, the velocity gradient is to be also zero. And I know because of the energy equation in the isentropic stream above the plate, that the gradient of enthalpy, streamwise variation of the enthalpy, also needs to be zero. So makes us very happy because then I can cancel all these terms that are non-local. And then as a result, I would end up with these two equations. I would end up with the equation that C multiplied by F prime 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 plus F second. This will be equal to zero. That will be momentum, and then I will have that C multiplied by G prime divided by the Prandtl number, and then multiplied by F G prime. This will be equal to, this is all of this is zero, right? So I just need the viscous dissipation here. Minus C multiplied by gamma minus 1, multiplied by the Mach number square, and multiplied by F prime prime square. And I could also have, if you want, the enthalpy equation, but the enthalpy equation, if you realize, is going to stay the same because there are no non-local terms in the enthalpy equation except for this one, and this one is just a constant if its velocity is a constant. So that will be the boundary conditions will be the same, right? The same ones as we have been stressing here. So it will be just that at eta equals zero, F prime is equal to F, and this is equal to zero, and G is equal to GW. Or G prime is equal to zero, and at eta tending to infinity, then F prime needs to be equal, needs to tend to one, and G needs to tend to one. So nothing prevents me now from integrating this problem, right? In order to integrate this problem numerically, one will have to redefine these equations and transform them into a set of first order differential equations. So for instance, one could come here and take five different variables, right? Then I'm going to call them x1, x2, x3, x4, and x5, and say that x1 will be equal to f, x2 will be equal to f prime, x3 will be equal to f second, x4 will be equal to g, and x5 will be equal to g prime. So then as a result, I know that g1 prime is going to be equal to g2. I know that g2 prime is going to be equal to x3. And I know that x3 prime, I can actually obtain it from the momentum equation. So if I look at the momentum equation, I just need to expand this. And then I will have that, for instance, c multiplied by f prime 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 plus c prime multiplied by f prime prime. This will be equal to f prime prime with a minus sign. And that's it, right? So this f prime 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 will be equal to minus f prime prime minus c prime multiplied by f prime prime divided by c. If the gas is calorically perfect, this c is going to depend only on temperature, right? So that c is going to depend directly on temperature, and then temperature I can relate it to g. So as a matter of fact, dc, which is just rho divided by rho sub e and multiplied by mu divided by mu sub e, this is just the temperature T sub e divided by T, by the equation of state. And then here I could apply an exponential law for the, a power law for the temperature, right, in such a way that the viscosity depends as in the temperature as T divided by T sub e to the sigma. So then this, this Chapman-Rubesin parameter is just T divided by T sub e to sigma minus 1. And this is equal to G to sigma minus 1. So this coefficient is just G to the sigma minus 1. So I could actually do also C prime, right? So C prime is just sigma minus 1 multiplied by G, sigma minus 2 multiplied by G prime. And then I could substitute here, right? And say that, for instance, where is this? Say, for instance, that x3 will be equal to minus x1, right? Here, f prime prime, that will be x3. So here will be minus. Here we have c prime, so that will be this entire thing here. G is actually x4, and G prime is x5. And all of this should be divided by C, and C is just x4 to sigma minus 1. So that will be another differential equation, right? Then another one would be that x4 prime will be equal to x5. And then the last one, x5 prime, and we need to get it from the temperature equation, from the second equation. So if I look at this equation, and I assume also that the Prandtl number is, I have a prime there too. So by the way, you are not telling me anything when I forget the primes, but to keep an eye on whether I make a mistake or not. So this, here I have a prime too, right? So what I could do is to expand this operator here and say that, right, so I could rewrite this as following, just by expanding this operator here. So that will be C G prime prime will be equal to minus the Prandtl number multiplied by F multiplied by G prime multiplied minus C multiplied by the Prandtl number multiplied by gamma minus 1 multiplied by the Mach square, and then multiplied by f prime prime square. And then I would need also the other term, so that would be plus minus C prime G prime. And then the only thing I need to do is to divide everything by C here. And that will give me the final ODI that I need. So, it's a, so that will be minus Prandtl. Right. This is x1. This g prime is x5. So here I will need another minus c. That will be minus x4 to gamma minus 1. Then we need another Prandtl there. Here I will need a gamma minus 1 multiplied by the mag at the edge square and then multiplied by f prime prime square. So that will be x3 square. And then here I will need minus sigma minus 1 multiplied by x4 sigma minus 2 multiplied by x5 and then multiplied by g prime, so square. And then all of this needs to be divided by C, which is actually x4 to sigma minus 1. So you can see here that I have 1, 2, 3, well, it should be 4, and 5. First order ordinary differential equations, right, that I could integrate in replacing these two third order ordinary differential equations. So I could integrate this easily, right, with because they are just first order equations. And they will be subject to the following conditions. At theta equal to 0, then I will know that x1 is equal to 0, then x2 is equal to 0, x3, I don't know, x4 will be equal to let's say a value, right, that will be equal to jw, and x5, I don't know. That's assuming that the wall is isothermal. Then at the eta going to infinity, then x1 tends to a value that I don't know which value is that. X2 tends to 1. X3 tends to a value that I don't know what is it. X4 tends to 1. And X5 tends to a value that I don't know what is it. It's probably most likely 0. But well, so the way of solving this system of five ODEs is actually, for instance, by using a shooting method. A shooting method in which one assumes a value here for f double prime and for g prime, assumes here two values. And with those two values, one checks whether these two boundary conditions here are satisfied at infinity. And then one can update these shooting parameters, for instance, by using a Newton-Raphson method. So the result is something that I'm going to show you in a second, but let me just tell you that in all of these analyses, you have seen here a GW, right? Here, for instance, the GW is representative of the temperature of the wall. And in order for me to claim that this is a problem that is globally self-similar, not only the edge conditions should be uniform, also this wall temperature should be also uniform, right? Well, one can also do a self-similar formulation by using a variable wall temperature. For instance, a plate, right, that whose temperature varies in the streamwise direction. But this variation needs to be slow, right? It needs to be slow. The variation of the temperature in the streamwise direction needs to be slow. And in particular, one can only afford having variations that are variations of the wall temperature in the streamwise direction, they need to be much smaller than the edge temperature minus the TW, the wall temperature divided by the thickness of the boundary layer. So these are weak variations of the temperature that can actually be inserted in the analysis. It's something that I'm not going to do here, but it's something that, for instance, you have in the paper that I'm highlighting in the screen. So this is a paper written actually by Chapman and Rubesin. Dean Chapman was an engineer at NACA and then later at NASA. And he was responsible for many studies during the Apollo program. He played an important role in the development of re-entry trajectories. So he was one of the first ones actually formulating the equations of motion for a re-entering body from space. And then he later worked also on the re-entry corridor. So he was the first one who calculated the width of a re-entry corridor for the Apollo capsule. This is something we will see in the last chapter of this course. And then he later became also director of astronautics at the NASA Ames Research Center. And later than that, he came to Stanford as a professor. Well, coming back to here, right, we are not going to worry too much about these variations of GW. And what I'm going to do is to integrate this problem numerically. And you actually have some results in the screen. So here, in this first figure, what you have is the self-similar variable eta, right, in the vertical axis. And in the horizontal axis, you have either F prime, G, or M. So those are the dimensionless velocity, the dimensionless static temperature, and the dimensionless stagnation temperature. So this integration is done for an adiabatic wall, right? The Prandtl is unity, and the H Mach number is equal to 6. So in this plot, you can see that for instance, the F prime, right, the red line, looks like a velocity profile, right? It looks like a velocity profile. It goes to 0 at the wall, and then it goes to 1 at the edge. And then the dimensionless static temperature, you see there that the blue line, that it arrives with zero slope at the wall, indicating that the wall is adiabatic. And then the stagnation temperature, the green line there, is actually constant. And that tells you that what we were anticipating before, without solving any of these equations, that the stagnation temperature is constant across a boundary layer over an adiabatic wall at unity Prandtl numbers, is something that you can see now in the screen being ratified numerically. So we could transform this figure. Instead of plotting it versus eta, I could try to plot it versus a physical variable, right? That is a little bit more intuitive than an integral of the density. Remember, this eta is a Haworth-Oroditchian variable that is density weighted, right? So I could go back to physical space by doing the following. So if I come here, so I know that the gradient of eta, or the variation of eta with respect to y, by using the Leibniz rule here, is just rho multiplied by u sub e, right, divided by the square root of 2 xi. So one could integrate this thing once for uniform edge conditions and say the following. So for instance, I put the eta on one side, and here rho, and then on the other side I will put the u sub e divided by the square root of 2 xi and multiply by this, the differential of y. I know that for constant values of the edge, of the edge quantities, xi, I showed you in the last discussion that xi is equal just by integrating this definition of xi. If the edge quantities are constant, this is equal to rho sub e, mu sub e, multiplied by u sub e, and multiplied by x. So I can also substitute this there. The density here, I know that for a calorically perfect gas, this density is inversely proportional to g, because g is the dimensionless enthalpy, and if the gas is calorically perfect, the enthalpy is proportional to the temperature, and the temperature is inversely proportional to the density. So here, I could rewrite this as g, the eta, divided by rho sub e, And here I could rewrite it as u sub e divided by the square root of 2 rho sub e mu sub e u sub e and multiply by x and then d of y. So I could trivially take the rho sub e to the other side. And here, you know, if I look at this expression, I can actually further simplify, right, the numerator and the denominator. So I could say that this is equal to the square root of rho sub e multiplied by u sub e multiplied by x and divided by mu sub e. And here I could have this of y and here an x. And I would also need here on the side a 1 over the square root of 2. This number here is the or the number that is inside this square root. I think we can recognize it that it's a Reynolds number. So in particular, is the h Reynolds number based on x. So I'm going to denote it as re at the edge based on x. So that will be rho sub e u sub e multiplied by x and divided by mu sub e. So this is the h Reynolds number. So I could, as I said, integrate this trivially, right, and obtain, right, so this function g depends on eta, so I need to be careful, but this entire prefactor does not depend on y. So at the end, I'm going to have a y multiplied by the square root of re at the edge based on x divided by x is equal to the square root of 2 multiplied by the integral from 0 to eta of g of eta, d eta. Well, so for those of you that you have taken classes in boundary layer theory, I think you are capable of recognizing that this quantity here is an inverse of a boundary layer thickness. Right, so in particular, I could define here a boundary layer thickness without me knowing anything about about compressible boundary layers. I could define here a baseline boundary layer thickness as x divided by the square root of the Reynolds number at the edge based on x. So that will be a baseline boundary layer thickness, right? The same one, the same definition that we would use for incompressible boundary layers. So then if I insert this into this equation, right, then I would obtain a relation between the physical space and the eta space. So let me just here substitute this quantity in between the dashed lines by the following. That will be y divided by delta v naught. I can go from eta space to physical space just by using this definition. So the in the slide, right, what you're going to see are the same profiles that I was showing you before based on eta. Now I'm plotting them based on the physical coordinate y divided by that baseline boundary layer thickness. So here you can see in the left the velocity profile, again for a Mach number 6 and an adiabatic wall, still for unity Prandtl numbers. And then on the right, you can see the temperature, the static temperature and the stagnation temperature. Again, just pay attention to the stagnation temperature, right? The stagnation temperature remains constant across the boundary layer when the wall is adiabatic and the Prandtl number is unity. So here you can also see that the baseline boundary layer thickness, which is that delta V naught, is perhaps not a good measure of the boundary layer thickness, because we can see that, for instance, in this plot, the boundary layer is 16 units thick compared to that delta V naught, right? So that already tells us that there is something going on here that probably it is not good for us to borrow the exact definition of delta V naught from the incompressible theory. But we will go back to that later. So one thing that happens too when one changes the Prandtl number, So if one decreases the Prandtl number, for instance, now we have a Prandtl number similar to the Prandtl number that you have in air, right? 0.72, still the same Mach number. This is also a boundary layer of an anadiabatic wall. So you see that the blue line is still arriving with zero slope at the wall. And then the stagnation temperature, this dimensionless stagnation temperature, is no longer uniform, right? So it has a small variation within the boundary layer. So if we transform this into physical space, then we see here on the left, we have the velocity profile, right? In terms again of a vertical coordinate divided by that baseline boundary layer thickness. And then on the right, we have the temperature, the static temperature and the stagnation temperature. So you see that for non-unity Prandtl numbers, the stagnation temperature is no longer uniform, right? And it's no longer uniform because of those extra terms that we had in the stagnation temperature equation. If you go back to your notes, you will see that there is an extra term in the stagnation temperature equation that arises when the Prandtl number is not equal to 1, and that extra term depends on the gradient of the static temperature. Well, so one could also try to calculate the recovery factor, right? Recovery factor numerically. And we can also do that because, in principle, for every Mach number, I can solve an adiabatic problem. So if I solve a boundary layer over an adiabatic wall, I'm going to have values of one value of a wall, adiabatic wall temperature per Mach number, right? So if you recall here, the recovery factor was defined as TAW minus T sub E divided by the stagnation temperature at the edge minus T sub E. So that is to say that when the wall temperature and the stagnation temperature at the edge are the same, then the recovery factor is the same, is unity, sorry. So you can also see this if I provide here the definition of the adiabatic wall temperature, which is just the edge static temperature plus the recovery factor multiplied by gamma minus 1 divided by 2 and multiplied by the velocity squared and divided by Cp. So if the recovery factor is equal to 1, then this entire quantity will be just the edge stagnation temperature. Well, according to the results in the screen, that recovery factor is smaller than 1, right? Unless the Prandtl number is equal to 1. If the Prandtl number is equal to 1, then necessarily the stagnation temperature needs to be uniform, right? And since the adiabatic wall temperature is equal to the edge stagnation temperature and the stagnation temperature is uniform everywhere, then both the adiabatic wall temperature and the stagnation temperature everywhere, they need to be the same. So as a result, one has a unity recovery factor for Prandtl 1. Then as one lowers the Prandtl number, then the recovery factor starts departing from 1. The question is, what is the value of the recovery factor? Because one actually needs it, for instance, for calculating the Stanton number. So there is a simple model for the recovery factor that you see in the screen. In the solid lines, you have the numerical solution, and in the dashed lines, you have a model, which is the square root of the Prandtl number. And you see that when one approximates the recovery factor as the square root of the Prandtl number, the result is actually not that bad. So it looks very much as the numerical solution. So a good approximation for the recovery factor in laminar boundary layers is that the recovery factor is equal to the square root of the Prandtl number. So for, by the way, just so you see the also things related to turbulent boundary layers, for a turbulent boundary layer, the recovery factor is even closer to 1. So for a turbulent boundary layer, the dependency is Prandtl to the 1/3. So the recovery factor is even closer to 1 for a turbulent boundary layer. Well, but this is a model here that works very well for laminar boundary layers, at least for laminar boundary layers of chaotically perfect gases. So one can also, if we go back to the screen, try to take the same problem, right, for a boundary layer over an adiabatic wall and start varying the Mach number. So if one varies the Mach number here, you see that the first of all, the wall temperature or the adiabatic wall temperature actually increases, right? And increases because the adiabatic wall temperature is proportional to the Mach number squared. And then secondly, what you see when one increases the Mach number is that the boundary layer becomes thicker, right? The boundary layer becomes thicker. And it is not surprising that the boundary layer becomes thicker. In general, as I said, as one increases the Mach number, then the temperature within the boundary layer is going to increase, right? If the temperature in the boundary layer increases, then one is going to have larger variations of the density. So those variations of the density, they generate a thermal expansion effect that actually thickens the boundary layer. So one could also do similar calculations, but this time for an isothermal wall, right? I changed here the boundary condition, and now it's no longer adiabatic, now it's isothermal. And the wall to edge static temperature ratio is 4, that you can see on the right lower corner of the screen. Well, you can see too that here, that as one increases the Mach number, also the boundary layer thickness increases, right? Most interestingly, if you look at the right figure, if one goes from Mach 2 to Mach 6, you see a fundamental variation in the temperature profile. And it is that at Mach 2, the temperature profile arrives at the wall with a negative slope, indicating that the wall is actually being cooled down by the flow, right? But then as one increases the Mach number, in particular one passes through the barrier of 4, then the profile at 4 looks more or less adiabatic, looks more or less like it is arriving with zero slope at the wall, and then at higher Mach numbers, then one has a reversal in the slope. So now the slope is positive at the wall. And you can see there the non-monotonicity of the temperature that we were already advancing in the first discussion related to boundary layers. So at Mach 6, right, the wall is said to be cold in the sense that at Mach 6, the wall temperature is now smaller than the adiabatic wall temperature. And as a result, the temperature profile displays that peak there. So if you recall, right, there was a time, I think 1 week ago, that I argued that as one increases the Mach number, right, as one increases the Mach number, then the temperature profile goes from monotonic to arriving with zero slope, and then to having this peak there. So that will be with increasing Mach numbers, right? So I also told you that the critical Mach number was 1. The critical edge Mach number was 1, such that the wall temperature will be similar to the adiabatic wall temperature. Remember that this adiabatic wall temperature increases with the Mach number. So as soon as this limit is achieved, then one starts developing in the boundary layer a non-monotonic temperature profile, and with that one has aerodynamic heating. So this critical Mach number was given by 2 divided by the recovery factor multiplied by gamma minus 1 and multiplied by Tw over T sub e minus 1, the square root of this. So I anticipated this in a lecture, 2 or 3 lectures ago. And this number here for this ratio being 4, this number is very close to 4. It's actually 4.2 if you calculate it. So above 4.2, one would start having aerodynamic heating. So if we go back to the screen, you see that at 4, the profile is already almost adiabatic, and above 4, according to the, or in accordance with these predictions, one was able to one consider that one has the non-monotonic temperature profile. So this is also a lesson to learn that sometimes one doesn't need to use the computer to anticipate the stuff. So one can actually anticipate the stuff just by looking at the conservation equations. Well, so if we go back to this adiabatic case, right, that we saw before, and I start varying the Mach number, as I said before, the baseline boundary layer thickness that I'm using there perhaps is not the best, because as you can see, as I increase the Mach number, this boundary layer thickness starts increasing. So for instance, at Mach 6, I already have 18 units of boundary layer thickness compared to the baseline boundary layer thickness. So as I said before, this scaling that I'm using with delta V naught in the vertical axis is perhaps not the best. And as a matter of fact, there is a better scaling that one can use. It is based on It is based not on the H Reynolds number, so while I was saying before that the delta V naught, the incompressible boundary layer thickness, goes like X divided by the square root of the H Reynolds number based on X, where the Reynolds number at the H based on X is just rho sub E multiplied by U sub E, multiplied by X and divided by mu sub E. There is a better scaling that actually one can use, and it is based on the on a Reynolds number that is based on wall quantities. I'm going to call it REW based on X. And this Reynolds number is equal to rho W multiplied by U sub E multiplied by X and divided by mu W. These are density and dynamic viscosity at the wall. So I could operate here, for instance, and say that this is equal to rho W divided by rho sub E multiplied by mu sub E divided by mu W, multiplied by rho sub E, multiplied by U sub E, multiplied by X, and divided by mu sub E. So this thing here is already the Reynolds number at the edge, so that one I know. And here what I could do is to apply the, this is a mu W. Here what I could do is to apply the equation of state. So this is going to be equal to TW divided by T sub E. And here I could use a power law for the dynamic viscosity, and this will be T sub E divided by TW to the sigma, and then here multiplied by REX, the Reynolds number at the edge based on X. So this is going to be just TW divided by T sub E power to sigma minus 1 multiplied by this Reynolds number at the edge based on X. So here I have this ratio, right? This temperature ratio that relates the wall based Reynolds number with the edge based Reynolds number. So I know that in an adiabatic wall, this wall temperature is similar to the, is actually equal to the adiabatic wall temperature. So, and as a matter of fact, this adiabatic wall temperature divided by T sub E, so this is of the order of T A W divided by T sub E to sigma minus 1. This number here actually goes as the Mach number at the edge square multiplied by sigma minus 1. By the way, I made a mistake, right? So you should tell me when I make a mistake. So here I made this mistake, and it is that I put the density, right? The density ratio proportional to the temperature ratio, and obviously it should not be like that, right? Should be inversely proportional. So this is my fault. So as a result, if I were to do this thing again, right? Let me just do it again, because you know, many often I make mistakes here. So this this temperature ratio, now I can multiply that by that, and then I will have T sub E divided by TW multiplied by a power to sigma plus 1 multiplied by the Reynolds number at the edge based on X. So now, as I was saying, I know that the wall temperature divided by T sub E for an adiabatic wall is actually equal to the adiabatic wall temperature divided by T sub E. And this number, at high Mach numbers, it goes like the Mach number at the H squared. So if I were to do this, right, then this number could be approximated as the Reynolds number at the H based on X divided by the Mach number at the h squared multiplied by sigma plus 1. So now I have a relation between the wall Reynolds number and the h Reynolds number, and that relation goes through or takes into account the Mach number. So if I am, now I go and I, instead of using this baseline boundary layer thickness, I use another delta, another boundary layer thickness, but this time based on this wall-based Reynolds number, that will be x divided by the Reynolds number based on the wall properties to the 1/2. Then what I could do is to use the relation, right? Use the relation between this this Reynolds number and this other Reynolds number. In doing that, you know, you need to also see that there is a Mach number here, so that will be equal to x multiplied by the Mach number at the edge to sigma plus 1 divided by REW, sorry, divided by R, the Reynolds number at the edge based on X to the 1/2. So here this relation has a sigma, right? Sigma there. So let me assume for this sigma in general is 0.7, right? So 1 plus sigma is close to 2. So let me just say that this is similar to x multiplied by the Mach number at the h squared divided by the square root of the Reynolds number at the h based on x. So as you can see here, this boundary layer thickness that I'm redefining is just the Mach number at the h squared multiplied by the baseline boundary layer thickness that I would pick for a incompressible boundary layer. So how does this work, right? If I use this boundary layer thickness for a scaling instead of a traditional one, well, let's look at the screen. So these are profiles again for a for an adiabatic wall, right? So before, the profiles looked like this when I was using the baseline boundary layer thickness. And then when I rescale it by a boundary layer thickness based on the wall, based on the Reynolds number, that is itself based on the wall density and the wall dynamic viscosity, then you see a better collapse. In particular, you don't see a thickening of the boundary layer as the Mach number increases, and the vertical axis is actually contained within an order unity number. So that is to say that, for instance, the boundary layer thickness here is 3 units in delta V. So I think at the beginning, when we were talking about boundary layer effects over a hypersonic vehicle, I was emphasizing here that the boundary layer was a little bit thicker than an incompressible boundary layer, and that the scaling factor was actually the Mach number squared. So in this derivation, you can see what is the rationale for that. And the rationale for that is just based on the thermal expansion first and on the variations of viscosity with temperature. So one is to be careful, in particular, in general, when dealing with viscous hypersonic flows, it is actually very difficult to define characteristic properties within the boundary layer, for instance, to construct a Reynolds number, because those properties, the density and the viscosity, they vary across the boundary layer thickness. And the edge Reynolds number could be very different from the Reynolds number based on wall properties. So that should always be kept in mind when dealing with high-speed boundary layers. Well, so one could also look at another quantities, for instance, the skin friction and the Stanton number. So if you recall, right, the skin friction coefficient, CF, it's just tau, the viscous shear stress at the wall, divided by 1/2, multiplied by rho sub e, u sub e squared, right? So this tau w can be written as the viscosity at the wall multiplied by the velocity gradient at the wall and divided by 1/2 of rho sub e, u sub e squared. So here for the gradient, I could actually apply a transformation rule. So like follows, this will be equal to mu w multiplied by d eta d sub I at the wall, multiplied by d u d eta at the wall, and then again divided by 1/2 of rho sub e, u sub e squared. So here if I operate, this will be mu w, then this symmetric coefficient is just rho w multiplied by u sub e and divided by the square root of 2 c. Then this velocity gradient here will be just another u sub e here square, and then nf second at zero. I remember that u depends on f prime, so if I divide it another time, that will be f second. And here in the denominator, I will have 1/2 of rho sub e u sub e square. So here this u sub e square goes away with this u sub e square. And what I could do would be to say that this is 2. By the way, here I have 2 divided by the square root of 2. So that will give me the square root of 2. So here we have a rho w, mu w. In the denominator, I'm going to have a rho sub e. I'm going to multiply and divide by mu sub e. So here I will have a mu sub e. And here I will have this square root of c. And that is equal to the square root of rho sub e, mu sub e, u sub e, multiplied by x, and then here I will need an f prime prime as zero. So if I simplify this, this will be equal to the square root of 2 multiplied by the Chapman-Rubesin parameter at the wall, and then multiplied by f second as zero, f prime prime as zero, and then divided by the square root of the Reynolds number based on the edge and based on x. And based on x. So this will be the skin friction coefficient. So once that I have the wall boundary conditions and I have this the solution to the self-similar problem, I automatically have the distribution of the skin friction coefficient. So this is something that, for instance, you can see in the screen. So here what I'm showing on the left is the skin friction coefficient versus the edge Reynolds number based on x. So in general, the skin friction coefficient decreases with the Reynolds number based on x. But you can also see that if I go and I change the Mach number, an increase in the Mach number actually decreases the skin friction coefficient. And that makes sense because, as I was telling you before, an increase in the Mach number means that you have a thicker boundary layer. So a thicker boundary layer is going to mean a smaller shear stress on the wall. And as a result, the Mach number, and as a result, the skin friction coefficient decreases with the Mach number. So on the right, you have the skin friction coefficient again versus the Reynolds number at the edge. And there you can see that there are three different curves with three different dimensionless wall temperatures. So in particular, as one decreases the wall temperature, then one is going to increase the skin friction coefficient. So I will repeat again, as one makes the wall colder, the skin friction actually increases. And that has to do with the fact that as one makes the wall colder, the thickness of the boundary layer actually decreases, right? So that increases the skin friction coefficient. In order to see this, for instance, we can go back here to the results, right? And for instance, if you look at the figure on the right and you pay attention to the temperature profile at Mach 6, you see that the temperature profile at Mach 6 has the boundary layer corresponding to that profile has a thickness of almost 14 units, let's say, 12 to 14 units in delta V naught. So if I go and I make the wall adiabatic, that is to say that I increase the wall temperature, you see that now at Mach 6, the boundary layer is actually thicker, right? So this is to say the following. If you look at this figure on the right at Mach 6, if you decrease the temperature, the wall temperature, so you make the temperature colder, then the boundary layer thickness is going to decrease, right? So that's a conclusion, is that cold boundary layers in general have thinner boundary layers. Cold walls actually lead to thinner boundary layers. And thinner boundary layers actually mean more stable boundary layers. So, and as a result, one has an increase in the skin friction coefficient. Well, one could also derive an expression for the Stanton number. So, for instance, if one comes here, then the Stanton number will be just the heat flux at the wall divided by rho sub E, multiplied by U sub E, multiplied by Cp, multiplied by the temperature difference between the adiabatic wall temperature and the wall temperature. So this, I can express the wall heat flux as the thermal conductivity at the wall multiplied by the temperature gradient at the wall. And then again, rho sub E, U sub E, Cp, Taw, minus Tw. So here I could also apply again the transformation rule. So that would be Kw multiplied by dieta dy at the wall, multiplied by dt dieta at the wall, and here divided by rho sub E, U sub E, Cp, multiplied by Taw, minus Tw. So if I operate here, that would be Kw. So Kw, what I'm going to do is to use the definition of the Prandtl number, and I'm going to express it as mu w multiplied by Cp and divided by the Prandtl number. So this dieta dy can be written as rho w multiplied by u sub e and divided by the square root of 2c. And this dieta dt dieta can be written as t sub e, and since t depends on g, so the derivative of g with respect to eta, that will be just g prime at zero. And then in the denominator here, I will have rho sub e, I will have u sub e, I will have Cp, Taw, minus Tw. Well, so here what I could do is to operate again, right? So this u sub e goes away with this u sub e, this Cp goes away with this Cp, and then what I could do too is to multiply and divide by the viscosity, and say that this will be mu w, rho w, divided by rho sub e, mu sub e. So here I will have a mu sub e, and here I will have a square root of 2, and I will also have a square root of c. So that will be rho sub e, mu sub e, u sub e, multiplied by x. And here I will have t sub e. I'm running out of space here, so I'm going to erase this. T sub e divided by Tw minus T sub e. And then here we have a g prime of zero. So if I look at this entire expression, this is going to give me Cw divided by the square root of 2 multiplied by T sub e divided by Taw minus T sub e, and multiply by the g prime of zero, and divided by the square root of the Reynolds number at the edge based on x. Right? Yeah, put this at the edge based on x. So this will be the formula for the Stanton number. So the Stanton number can be computed as soon as I have the similarity solution. I can calculate the Stanton number. And in particular, there is a quantity that I think is a figure of merit, typically seen, typically investigated in boundary layers, that is called the Reynolds analogy factor. So this Reynolds analogy factor that I would call it, for instance, R A, that will be twice multiplied by the Stanton number and divided by the skin friction coefficient. We saw in one of the first lectures, I was capable of showing you without integrating numerically anything, that the Reynolds analogy factor for a Prandtl unity boundary layer over, oh sorry, for a Prandtl unity boundary layer of a calorically perfect gas was equal to 1. This Reynolds analogy factor would allow me to go exactly from the skin friction coefficient to the Stanton number with a Reynolds analogy factor equal to 1. Well, in general, if the Prandtl number is not equal to 1, then the Reynolds analogy factor is not equal to 1. So one could obtain here the factor just by dividing these two quantities, dividing this Stanton number and dividing this skin friction coefficient, right? So you see that the Reynolds numbers, they are going to go away, right? Because I have here a square root of the Reynolds number and a square root of the Reynolds number here. What I will have will be that this will be just 2 divided by the square root of 2, so that will give me the square root of 2. With that square root of 2, it will disappear. This Chapman-Rubesin parameter will disappear with that 1. And then I will have g prime of 0. And here I will have an f prime prime of 0. And what I will need will be just the temperature ratio, T sub E divided by T A W minus T sub E. So that will be, in general, the form of the Reynolds analogy factor. This Reynolds analogy factor is not 1 for boundary layers of gases with non-unity Prandtl number. So we can see the distribution, actually, of the Reynolds analogy factor in the slide. So here, what you have is a the Reynolds analogy factor in the vertical axis versus the Mach number. So you see that at Prandtl 1, the Reynolds analogy factor is 1, as we anticipated before. So for a non-unity Prandtl number boundary layers, then the Reynolds analogy factor departs from 1, and you can see the solution in the solid line. So this is for a given temperature ratio that you have on the right lower corner of the screen. By the way, ignore that Mach 6 that appears on that right lower corner of the screen, because this boundary layer, the Mach numbers of this boundary layer, they range from 5.5 to 8.5. So you can see that the numerical solution is actually very close to that dashed line that is a Prandtl number to the minus 2/3. And it is that it is a good model for non-unity Prandtl number boundary layers at high speeds, that this entire Reynolds analogy factor can be approximated as the Prandtl number to the minus 2/3. It's a good model for laminar boundary layers, and actually it's also a good model for turbulent boundary layers to some extent, even though you will see, if you look at the literature of turbulent boundary layers, that this Reynolds analogy factor is closer to 1.16, right? So if we go back to the slide, for a turbulent boundary layer, the Reynolds analogy factor will be closer to 1.16 instead of 1.25. So, but still, it is within this ballpark too. So this appears to be a good model for the Reynolds analogy factor. Well, let me just conclude this lecture by telling you the following, and it is that, for instance, if I here and so we have seen that the wall heat flux can actually be written by using just the definition of the Stanton number, can actually be written as the Stanton number multiplied by rho sub E, multiplied by U sub E, multiplied by Cp, and multiplied by the difference between the wall adiabatic temperature and the wall temperature. right? So that's an exact definition of a wall heat flux. Well, it's important here to notice the following. So at high Mach numbers, this adiabatic wall temperature is actually larger than the wall temperature. It's actually much larger than the wall temperature. So, and in particular, this adiabatic wall temperature goes like the Mach number square. So this entire thing here, right? So if I were to, for instance, develop this, this would be T sub E plus U sub E square divided by 2Cp. I have a recovery factor here somewhere, right? But I'm going to ignore it for now. And then here we have a minus Tw. So at high velocities, the term here that is dominant is this, is the kinetic term, right? Is the temperature derived from the kinetic energy. So if I ignore these other two terms, right, at low Mach numbers, then this wall heat flux can actually be written as a Stanton number multiplied by rho sub E, multiplied by U sub E, multiplied by Cp, multiplied by U sub E squared divided by 2Cp. So here you can see that this Cp and this Cp, they go away. And then this is going to be equal to the Stanton number multiplied by rho sub E and multiplied by U sub E cubed divided by 2. That's a very important result. It's a very important result, as a matter of fact, because it tells us that the wall heat flux scales with this group that you have here. This density multiplied by the velocity cube, right? If you recall, the drag force actually scales with the density multiplied by the velocity square. So the heat flux actually scales with the velocity cube. So that's a fundamental difference between drag and heat flux. And it is that as the hypersonic vehicle goes faster, the drag is going to increase parabolically with the velocity, but the heat flux is going to increase as the velocity cube. So, and that also goes back to the problem of the heat barrier, right? So the problem of the heat barrier becomes soon very concerning because of this cubic dependency of the heat flux on the velocity. We'll see later too that this quantity here varies in a very characteristic manner through the atmosphere, because as I told you before, the density is very low in the upper layers of the atmosphere, but the velocity is very high, and vice versa. When the altitude is low, typically the velocity is slow, and the density is high. So there is also a maximum attained within the atmosphere of this product that maximizes the heat flux on the wall. So just to conclude, whenever you have a boundary layer, right, which is a hypersonic vehicle on a wall, so there is going to be most likely at very high Mach numbers, the wall is going to be cold. It's going to be, the temperature of the wall is going to be smaller than the adiabatic wall temperature. So you have here T sub E and a velocity, a Mach number much larger than one. So the temperature profile is going to develop here a peak, right, close to the wall. And there is going to be a large thermal load. A large thermal load acting on the fuselage. And the result, this process here, is always termed aerodynamic heating. It's one component of aerodynamic heating, and in particular is viscous heating, because there are other components of aerodynamic heating related to radiation, for instance. So this is one manifestation of aerodynamic heating that is very important for the design of hypersonic vehicles. In the next lecture, we will see another different manifestation of aerodynamic heating that is due to the heat fluxes that emerge at the stagnation point at the forebody of the hypersonic vehicle.